Our guest tonight is Edgar Smith. He was discharged an hour and a half ago from the death house at Trenton, New Jersey, to which he was sent with orders that he be executed in May of 1957. He was in the death house longer than anyone in the history of the United States. Now, what happened between May 1957 and this afternoon is the subject of interest for lawyers, criminologists, jurists, and human beings. Edgar Smith went to the death house swearing that he was innocent of the killing of a 15-year-old girl. The circumstantial evidence against him was very strong, so strong that most people, reading the reports of the trial, believed him guilty. But there were those who didn't. His trial lawyer, for instance, was totally convinced of his innocence. A private investigator, Mr. Andy Nickel, came to the offices of National Review 9 years ago and attempted to demonstrate to the editors that it was flatly impossible for Edgar Smith to have killed Victoria Zielinski as charged by the state of New Jersey. Meanwhile, he came twice within hours of execution, but a Trenton lawyer, Stephen Lichtenstein, intervened, finding imperfections in the legal proceedings that arrested the attention of the courts. Subsequently, a Washington lawyer, Steve Heumann, joined the defense and managed to catch the attention of the Supreme Court, which ruled that the critical evidence used against Smith had been gotten after hours of interrogation of a kind that are inconsistent with the assumption that the defendant's statement was necessarily truthful. The Supreme Court set into motion a series of proceedings that resulted in an ultimatum from the federal courts to the courts of New Jersey. Either try Smith again within 60 days or set him free. This afternoon, shortly before the deadline, Edgar Smith appeared before a New Jersey judge, Morris Pashman, and pleaded non vult, which means in effect guilty. The judge dutifully executed his part of the bargain. He sentenced Smith to murder in the second degree, or rather convicted him of murder in the second degree, sentencing him to 25 to 30 years in jail, and suspended the balance of the undischarged sentence. Which is why tonight he will sleep other than in an 8x8 prison cell in solitary confinement for the first time since the police interrupted him at Marwan, New Jersey, in the trailer where he lived with his wife and months-old daughter, and took him in for interrogation. Meanwhile, in prison, he became probably the most famous death cell inmate in America. He learned the law and for a period managed his own legal defense. Then in 1968, he smuggled a manuscript out of prison, and the august firm of Alfred Knopf published his account of his case, Brief Against Death, which became a bestseller. Then he published a novel. Now he is working on another book on penal reform. Recently, he published a self-interview in Esquire magazine, and he is busy writing book reviews for Playboy. The dramatic events of today leave his readers and some of his friends astounded. Why should he now, having won the important legal battle, plead guilty? It is to throw light on this episode and on the implications of it and on other matters of ultimate human concern that Edgar Smith is here. I wish to make only this point. Edgar Smith pleaded guilty in a court of law, and in return, the judge let him go free. He cannot formally renounce that plea because he is on probation. But he can answer questions about why he did as he did. And since I am not on probation, I can say in behalf of myself and of the many others who have studied the case and the circumstances and who know the man who is here tonight, that we believe profoundly that on March 5th, 1957, he left Victoria Zielinski alive. I should like to begin by asking Mr. Smith, why didn't you go for a new trial?
There are probably more reasons than I could ever list at the present time. One reason was the monetary reason. I had spent as much money as I had ever made on all my books. I had exhausted what little money I had left in the course of fighting the state's appeals from the reversal of my conviction. I had used up as much money of my family's money as I had cared to use. And I was in a financial situation where I just didn't want to turn to friends anymore or turn to the family anymore. I couldn't do it myself. There was the problem also of my former wife and my daughter. My wife left me in 1962. Is remarried, is living out west, has several children. Her friends and neighbors know nothing about the events of the past that she was involved in 1957. My daughter knows nothing of the fact that I am, or I was, in the death house. There were reasons to believe that if there were a trial again, that my wife would be a witness, as she was in 1957. I just didn't want to put her through that ordeal again. I didn't want to have my daughter know what had happened to me, what had happened to her father. There were considerations with the jury, with the possibility of a jury trial in Burden County. We knew it was going to be very, very difficult to find a jury in that county, which would probably not lean toward conviction. The press coverage, since the conviction was reversed, was not much different than it was in 1957. For instance, since my conviction was reversed, and I was, for the past 3 months, only a defendant, only accused of the crime, still, there were newspapers in that county which referred to me as Edgar Smith, convicted murderer. They talked about events of 1957, which probably would not be admissible. The facts of those events would probably not be admissible in a new trial. And yet, the fact that the press was reporting those events and that they were being read by the jurors left me with the feeling that it would be very, very difficult to get a fair trial in that county. But it would also be difficult to have the trial moved out of that county. We just can't go in and say, I suppose the jury would be prejudiced. We had to prove that, and that would have been difficult. And we considered all these factors and what would be gained by a trial, what would be lost by a trial, and we felt it would be better to resolve the case this way. Well, my attorneys and I, we discussed this at great length over the past several weeks, and we felt that this would be the best resolution for everyone.
Well, in deciding as you did, did you feel that you were letting down people who had bought your book and who had written to you and who had in many ways expressed their belief in your innocence?
I considered that, and I also considered the fact that I had been in jail for 14 years and 9 months, and that it was probable that even though there was a federal court order requiring a new trial within 60 days, it was not likely that the trial could be held within that period of time, which would have expired this month, that there had to be pretrial motions made, technical motions which would have delayed the trial. Preparations for the trial were not completed. And when I looked at those things, and I looked at what I had been through over the 14 years, I felt that those persons who did read my book, who did favor me, would understand that what I did today was something I had to do to gain my freedom. It was not likely that I would have gained my freedom in the near future any other way. And it was a difficult choice, but it was just something I had to do if I wanted to be free.
Well, you wrote me about 4 or 5 months ago and said, I figure that anybody who thinks I'm innocent is going to think I'm innocent irrespective of whether I am formally exonerated by a court of law. Yes, and everybody who thinks I'm guilty is going to continue to think I'm guilty even if I am exonerated by a court of law. Under the circumstances, I net don't lose anybody by this particular device, if in fact, as you were unsure at the point, you decided to go through with it.
I don't think, really, that I'm going to change too many minds after this many years. That had I gone to trial, I had discussed it, had I gone to trial and been convicted, there would still be the doubt. Those who believed I was innocent would still have that doubt. And there would be more appeals and perhaps another reversal, I don't know. But the doubt would be there. On the other hand, if I were acquitted at a trial, there would still be doubt on the minds of those who believed I were guilty. I was guilty. They would say, well, it's been a many years, the witnesses have lost their memories, many witnesses have died, some of the evidence can't be used now. So really, I don't think the trial would have resolved it in any direction with any certainty. And the minds that had been made up on either side, I think, would have remained pretty much the same.
Well, now, this is very instructive for people, which means most Americans, who tend to figure that what you get from courts of law is the truth. Now, everybody who knows the adversary system, or anything about the adversary system, knows that it is designed to bring out the truth, but it settles very often for something much less than that. Now, you have a situation in which, however, people who are accustomed to believing that that which the court holds is true, are necessarily, are they not, moved to proceed on the assumption of your guilt. Now, if they do, then they move to a whole series of corollary assumptions, namely, didn't you make a monkey out of the law in virtue of the fact that you had several dozen rulings on your case, that you were always able to thwart the execution of your sentence? What is your position on the correspondence of that which a court finds and that which is actually true? Is it a coincidence, or at least a little better than that?
I'm not sure that the law is designed to bring out truth, as you stated it. It's to bring out such truth as may be brought out within the rules. Not all of the truth is always brought out. Only that truth which can be brought out between these very narrow rules of evidence. And quite often, it's difficult to bring out the truth. Tied up in these procedural rules, the rules of evidence, it's very difficult sometimes. And even if you do bring out what you believe to be the true facts, the facts of the situation, there's always a chance that a jury isn't going to see it the same way. They won't see it the same way you see it, won't see it the same way the prosecutor sees it, won't see it the same way the judge sees it. And it's not necessarily true that if you bring out the truth and the truth proves A, that the jury is going to come in and say, we find A. They might find B. And
well, that's presumably the reason why it is required that the jury find against you unanimously, correct? Before,
yes, in a murder case.
Yeah, Mm-hmm. Yes. Now, do you think that the jurors who convicted you in 1957 acted responsibly?
I think within what they were given, they did. And taking into consideration what they were instructed by the court, I think they did what they thought was right. Whether they did the right thing is something else, but they did what they thought was right.
Well, to what extent were they influenced by a press that was very hostile to you when you were caught, or when you were interrogated and indicted?
Well, I recall I wrote in Brief Against Death that of the jurors, the prospective jurors who were questioned regarding their reading of the pretrial press reports, 43% had said they had read those reports and they had been influenced by those reports to the degree that they could not render a fair verdict.
Well, then why did you say that they behaved responsibly?
Well, I think you can't say that the people on the jury felt that way, because the people on the jury said, well, we did read those reports, but we are going to be able to make an independent decision. We're not going to be influenced by what we read in the newspapers. They say that. Whether that's true or not, I don't know. But I believe that within what they were given, that they did what they thought was right.
So, in other words, they were influenced by the press, but having been influenced by the press, they were not in a position to detach the extent to which their animosity against you was fueled.
Well, I'm not sure they convicted
by
me.
By situations.
Yeah. I'm not sure they convicted me because they didn't like Edgar Smith, because they had any animosity toward me. I think they convicted me because they felt that the evidence, as it was explained to them by the court and as it was put before them by the prosecutor, indicated my guilt. And I don't agree with them. I believe they were mistaken in their interpretation of what they saw in that courtroom and what they heard in that courtroom. But I wouldn't say that they did it purposely or they had any malicious intent to convict me. I just think they made a mistake. But I think in their own minds, they did the right thing. They think that they did the right thing.
Well, why didn't the state of New Jersey proceed to try you? What was in it for the state of New Jersey to let you go free this afternoon when it could simply have gone back to a jury and attempted to convict you?
Oh, I think there were considerations on their part. The cost, the taking up the time of the court. In Bergen County at the present time, you have a very difficult situation in the prosecutor's office. The prosecutor has been suspended. He's under indictment. The office is being run by telephone from Trenton by the Attorney General. They have very few experienced prosecutors. This type of major case would be a great burden on that office. It would be a burden on the courts. I'm sure that there were considerations regarding the Zielinski family, whether they wanted to put them through the ordeal of a trial again. And I can't say what their final considerations were. Only they could say that. But I would assume that they felt on balance that this was a fair resolution of the case. They got what they wanted. They got their conviction. They vindicated their system. I think that's what they wanted more than anything else.
You say they vindicated their system.
In their mind.
Even though the federal courts threw out the conviction because of their disapproval of the way in which New Jersey proceeded against you.
Yes.
Point number one.
Yes.
And point number two, here you are in an ambiguous situation, to say the least, in which it seems awfully obvious to me and to an awful lot of other people that when you stepped forward this afternoon and said, yes, I killed her, what you were doing was executing an agreement with the court rather than adding to the sum of human knowledge.
Yes, that's
so
true.
So their vindication is formalistic, isn't it?
That's all I think they ever required. I think all the state of New Jersey ever really wanted to be able to do at the end of today is to go to the public and say, look, when we started this case, we made a lot of mistakes. We did a lot of things wrong, but we got the right guy in the end, and therefore our system works. And they can say, that's it. The case is now closed, and everybody can be happy because everybody can now know that their system is working for them. I think that's really what happened today.
Well, but don't they nevertheless suffer under the rebuke of the federal courts for having introduced into evidence a series of answers by you to questions which were coercive in character under the circumstances, or at least that was the finding of the federal court.
Yes, but again they come around with this and they say, well, we got the answers the wrong way, but Smith just proved today that we got the right answers, and therefore the thing works the right way.
But in the answers that were ruled as illegally extracted, you never said you killed the girl.
No.
So what they simply did was add to the circumstantial weight against you, is that correct?
Yes, but in the original statement, the question came up of why they never asked that question. And they said, well, it was understood. That was our way of doing it. It was understood that that question was implicit in the whole statement. And today it was specific and not just implied in the statement.
Is it true that you volunteered to submit to a truth serum test when you were arrested?
I did. I did submit to it.
What happened?
I don't know what the full results of that test were. There was a tape recording made of the examination by a state doctor. The following day, the
prosecutor... This was an examination what? Under
what? Truth, yeah, sodium amyl. And
is that pretty reliable?
Two doctors representing the state of New Jersey, two doctors representing myself, to ensure that there would be no questions as to the procedure or as to the injection itself, we allowed the state doctors to inject the drug and to lead the questioning. That was tape recorded. The following day, a transcript was made of that tape recording by the prosecutor's office. The tape recording was then erased, and to my knowledge, none of my lawyers have ever seen that transcript. We have seen portions of it. We have seen brief notes that were made by the doctors who were present, but we've never seen a complete transcript of that examination. However, in 1964, the New Jersey Supreme Court, in referring to that truth serum examination, stated that the results of that examination were substantially similar to my trial testimony at the 1957 trial, in which I denied the crime. And they said that those results and that testimony were substantially similar.
But now, if we all obviously know that somebody killed Victoria Zelinsky, some people who have read your book and read your self-interview in Playboy have wondered why it is that you have not devoted more attention to trying to get the man who did it. What is the reason for this? That you simply think he is...
Well, I've never directly said this person or that person or another person committed the crime. I said in the book, as I recall in a letter to you, I once said that I left her there alive. What happened after that, I don't know. But I left her there alive.
Well, it can't have been less than a subject of conjecture for you. Or is it your point that this is the kind of thing you don't want to conjecture about, at least publicly?
Well, at this point, it's very difficult for me because of...
Well, yeah.
Because of the probationary problem, because of...
Yeah.
...other problems.
Yeah, but why was it never worth while to attempt to find the guilty person? Why weren't your efforts directed towards doing that during the late 50s and 60s?
Well, it's impossible to do that and keep yourself alive at the same time. If I had a choice of either keeping myself alive when the state was trying to execute me or going off and trying to solve a crime for the state. I couldn't do both.
Is it your intention to try to find the killer now?
I don't think it's possible. I think this is one of those crimes that only the person who did it knows. And I don't think it will be possible after all this time, with so many people who have died, to really ever find the answer.
What did you learn on the basis of your experience in 1957? Let me see if I can briefly recall it. The crime is, say, midnight one day. At 11 o'clock the next night, the police come and they take you in for questioning.
Yes.
At 10 o'clock the next morning is the cutoff point as far as the federal courts were concerned, correct?
Yes, that's right.
Now, what is the meaning of that?
Anything after 10 o'clock was inadmissible.
On the grounds that at that point you had been overtaxed?
At that point, that is the point at which the judge felt that the coercive influence had been so great that anything after that would be inadmissible, yes. Although he had some question as to when the coercive influence was first applied, when the state first had me as their prime suspect and directed all their attention to me, the judge found that it was probably about 4 o'clock in the morning. But
at which point, theoretically, what should happen? You should be indicted?
Oh, I should be taken before a magistrate and arraigned. But that was put off. I should also be warned about certain rights. But in 1957, that was not a requirement. That was not mandatory. They didn't have to warn you. The Miranda rule didn't exist. But the judge felt that the crucial evidence that the state had to have, and in his opinion, he said that as of 10 o'clock in the morning, the very best they had was a second-degree murder case. And they probably had no more than that at that time. And that in order to get a first-degree case, they had to get statements from me. And from 10 o'clock on, what statements they didn't get are the statements that the court felt were inadmissible because they were beyond the period at which I should have been arraigned before a magistrate. And the prosecutor admitted he knew that. He knew that there was a federal state rule that required him to take me before the magistrate. And he testified in the federal court that even though he knew there was such a rule, he also knew that if he violated the rule, the courts would not do anything to him. That was perfectly all right to violate the rule. And therefore, he never bothered to arraign me until after he had everything he wanted.
Well, now, by 10 o'clock, in other words, you're saying, the prosecution decided that you were the guy who killed the girl, but they had only a second-degree case. In New Jersey, this... I say by 10 o'clock
yeah.
they had. Now, a second-degree case in New Jersey, which is the crime of which you were convicted this afternoon, means what, since second-degree means different things in different states?
In New Jersey, it's a maximum sentence of 30 years. But it means a murder without premeditation. And what they had to have is premeditation. And that is what they tried to get out of me through further questioning. Judge Gibbons made several comments about that in his opinion in the federal court when he overturned the conviction, that at that point the prosecution was just stopped. They just had nothing else. There was nowhere to go but back to me and to get me to say the things that would give them the case that they could then go before the jury and say, here is the first degree case.
Well, now, the judge this afternoon delivered, you will remember,
yes,
an extensive lecture.
I will remember for a long time.
Yeah, and in that lecture, he said a very interesting thing. He said, Mr. Smith, really, my own opinion is that the state of New Jersey never had more than a second-degree case against you. However, I am not rebuking the court that brought you to trial on a first-degree charge and convicted you of it, because this really was the only option that they had, given the fact that you tried to pin the blame on somebody else. Could you explain that to me?
I wish I could. I have no idea what that judge was talking about. It seems to me that what he is saying is that the state doesn't bring the charge against you based upon the evidence, but based on whether you will admit the crime or you'll deny the crime or say someone else committed the crime. And,
maybe he's trying
I really
to say,
don't know what the judge meant by that.
Well, maybe he's trying to say that in order to pin the blame on B, you had to say certain things which, having said them, gave the state an opportunity to say, well, if this much is true, we don't follow the conclusion that B was guilty, but we do come to the conclusion that there was premeditation, because otherwise what you... because... what you said about yourself made premeditation a logical inference. Is that what he was saying?
I really don't know what he was saying. I really didn't understand it. It was a fascinating statement, but I would have to look at it and read it to really understand it. It seemed to me he was saying that if you tell the truth, which truth to them means you admit that you do it, then it's second degree. But if you lie, which to them means if you deny you did it, then it's first degree. And it seems to me that that's what he was saying. I don't know. But he seemed to be saying that the degree of the crime and the degree of the charge the state would bring had nothing to do with the evidence. It had to do with your attitude and your cooperation or lack of cooperation. And the remarkable thing to say, I don't know if he meant it to sound that way.
Is it your opinion that if you had a new trial into which was admitted only that which the federal courts have ruled could properly be admitted, you would have been acquitted by a jury in Bergen County?
I doubt whether it would have happened in Bergen County.
I didn't ask you that.
No, I'd be acquitted in Bergen County.
Yeah.
I doubt whether I would have been acquitted in Bergen County.
Okay,
I think we had a
dual
problem with both the judiciary and the jury in Bergen County. It's possible that the chances would have been much greater in another county.
Much greater for what? Acquittal?
Acquittal, yes. I think we would have had a greater chance in another county. In Bergen County, I don't think the chances were that great.
What would you think your chances would have been of being acquitted of first-degree murder? No, outside of Bergen County.
Outside of Bergen County, I think the most it would have been, would have been a second-degree conviction, but I think in another county we would have won. In Bergen County, I doubt very much we would have won. I think there was too much against us in Bergen County.
Okay, now, on the basis of what you've said and what you've written, I think a lot of people who are very much concerned to bring criminals to justice face the possibility that in your case, what you see really is what people have known happens from time to time, namely that an overwhelming circumstantial case arises against an individual such as causes perfectly honest juries in many cases to come to... generalize from your case, or is it too singular to make that possible? If it is possible to generalize, what would you say are some of the structural deficiencies of the system which found you guilty in 1957?
I don't know if my case is a good one to generalize from, looking back at it from where we are now, but I think I faced problems in 1957 that almost everyone accused of crime faces. The first is money. The state has all the money they'll ever need to do whatever needs to be done. Most criminal defendants have little or no money. The state has the best lawyers. If they don't have them, they can get them. The criminal defendant has more often than not a public defender who has 250 cases to handle. He's overworked and he's underpaid. The state, if they need investigators, they have all the investigators they want. The criminal defendant, if he's lucky, the court will assign him one investigator, or the public defender's office will have an investigator who can work for him. In the scientific area, the state has everything they need. They have a state police laboratory. They can use private laboratories. They can use university laboratories. If necessary, they can use the FBI laboratory. The person accused of the crime has none of these. He could probably go to a private laboratory, but more than likely he can't afford it. He just doesn't have any of the cards to play the game. I think all criminal defendants face that same problem. I think even a wealthy criminal defendant faces that problem to some degree. That the state has the resources. They have a call on all the money and all the personnel they need and all the expertise they need. And very few people can get that. And therefore, you begin the game with the odds a little bit on the other side. And the presumption of innocence, I don't think, means too much in a courtroom. When you arrest a man and put him in jail, hold him for 7, 8, 9 months, a year, then bring him to trial, bring him into the courtroom in handcuffs, sit him down in front of the jury, take the handcuffs off, but then put two guards stand behind him. It's very difficult to say to that jury, this man is innocent. He hasn't done anything. He's innocent. The jury looks at him and says, well, what's he been doing in jail for a year? Why is he sitting in this courtroom? Why has he got these handcuffs on if he didn't do anything? He must have done something. I mean, there he is. He had to do something. And it, the presumption of innocence is a very difficult thing to believe in anymore. I don't know if you ever could believe in it. It may have been a time when there was such a thing as a presumption of innocence, but I don't think it exists anymore, and I think it's probably wrong to continue to pretend that it does exist.
Well, isn't it embodied in such notions as that you have to have a jury ruling unanimously against you, and the fact that you can take the Fifth Amendment and not take the trial and testify against you? Doesn't that give the defendant a whole lot of very important rights? And in any case, if what you say is correct, how come the conviction record is so unimpressive?
Probably because they have bad prosecutors.
I thought you said they had money and best of lawyers, best of laboratories.
They do,
and so
but
on.
It's probably because they're overworked. They plead most of their cases out. They may drop a lot of cases. A lot of the minor cases are just faded out. They just let them die out. They really can't handle them all anymore. Bergen County right now, they have a situation there where, in my case, they didn't even have a regular prosecutor, someone on the staff who could handle my case. They had to keep a man who was resigned, who was already resigned from the office. They had to keep him on as a special assistant prosecutor. And she was really the only man capable of handling a major case. And I think this has a lot to do with the conviction rate, but there are other problems. I agree that with those who say that there are problems in securing evidence these days. I'm not too sure I agree with all of the Supreme Court rulings on evidence. I think some of them may be overly restrictive, but I haven't studied this enough to say what the conviction rates are here or here or here, or why there are differences between them. And I don't necessarily agree that there are low conviction rates everywhere. I think the FBI, for instance, has a very high conviction rate. They have a very high record. Why they do, as opposed to some other police department, I don't know.
Although the situation in which you were particularly disadvantaged was a state situation.
Yeah.
So you've got the paradox that the states don't do very well by contrast with the federal people, and yet you were a victim of injustice.
I think the protections are much... I know the protections are much less in the state courts for a defendant. For instance, in 1957, when the police arrested me, they could take me in and they could question me from now till tomorrow morning and never once advised me that I had any rights in the world. Whereas in 1957, had the FBI arrested me, before they said anything to me, they would have had to advise me of all my rights. Whether this difference has anything to do with the conviction rate, there's greater professionalism in the FBI than there is in local police departments. Whether this has a difference in the conviction rate, I don't know. But I know that I would not have been treated in the federal court as I was in the state court. And I was never treated in the federal court as I was in the state court. My case went to the New Jersey State Supreme Court four times. The vote there was 28-0 against me. In the last series of appeals in the federal courts, on precisely the same grounds, and in fact on the exact same petition, the vote was 20-2 in my favor. Now this says something about the way the state courts, and somebody is wrong. It says something about the way the federal courts handle cases as opposed to where the state courts are. I don't think the state courts really give criminal appeals that much consideration anymore. I think they are prone to uphold convictions.
Could that implicit rebuke to New Jersey justice have been a factor in the proceedings of this afternoon,
in which
the sentencing judge devoted rather a lot of time to saying that obviously you were guilty.
I think it had a lot to do with it. There was never a time in 14 years and 9 months that any New Jersey judge on any issue ever voted in my favor.
Well, how'd you get out of the execution chamber? Was that done by federal intervention?
Yes, yes. There was never a time, except where the state courts gave me mandatory stays of execution. For instance, following your conviction, there is a mandatory stay of execution while you appeal to the state Supreme Court. On no issue did any state court, any state judge, ever vote in my favor. There was never a time in the United States Court of Appeals, for instance, where I did not have at least one judge vote in my favor. And the last time, the vote was 3-0 in my favor. And I don't think there's any doubt that what a great part of what happened in court today was the result of this. I call it an embarrassment. You call it a rebuke. I think it's just an embarrassment to New Jersey that here, after all these years, they never found anything wrong. And I went into the federal courts and they couldn't find anything right. I went to the United States District Court, one judge, he voted in my favor. Went to the United States Court of Appeals, 3 judges upheld that. Went to the United States Supreme Court, all 7 justices voted not to hear the state's appeal. I think that's an embarrassment to New Jersey, that there could be that great a disparity on precisely the same petition. In fact, the petition on which I won by those votes in the federal court, the New Jersey Supreme Court voted 7-0 not to consider. They didn't vote it down on the merits. They voted not even to read it.
When you arrived at the Trenton State Penitentiary in 1957, sentenced to death, were they at that point regularly executing people who were sent there for that purpose?
Not at precisely that time. They had been the last execution had been about 6 months before. But in that prior year, 56, 55, 54, 53, there, I suppose there had been 20, 25 people executed. I think there were somewhere around 7 or 8 executed in 1956. As many as 3 or 4 at a time.
And how many during the period that you were there?
During the time I was there, there were 3 executions. I believe there was one at the end of 1962 and 2 in 1963, all within a 6-month period, 3 executions.
Well, now, when you went, at a time that you went to the death cell, what was the normal span of time between an arrival there and either being released for a new trial or whatever, or execution? What was
typical? It was running somewhere in the neighborhood of a year to a year and a half. There were very, very few cases being appealed to the state courts at that time. Supreme Court rulings, which came later and opened up the federal courts to state appeals, had not yet been made. And it was very difficult to appeal to the state court, to the federal courts. There were 2 men in the death house when I arrived there who had been there about 5 years. And to those who came later, this was almost an unbelievable amount of time, 5 years. Nothing had ever happened like that before in New Jersey. And those 2 men, I think they did about 5 years and 11 months. And they both won new trials. They were partners. And they both walked out of prison within the last couple of months. They were both commuted by Governor Cahill and allowed to walk out. Mm-hmm. One of them left a few weeks ago. But at that time, that anyone would be in a death house for 5 years, it just seemed unbelievable. They talked about them in all the prisons and the county jails around the state.
And is it possible to have conversation in the death house to the point of being able to explore the attitudes of adjacent prisoners on the subject of capital punishment, or did your own conclusions about its deterrent value come to you simply from your own experience?
Well, I think the when you get into a discussion with men who are on death row, tends to get very emotional, and they tend to be opposed to it. And it's really a very difficult thing to explore with people who are subject to it.
Is it because they won't talk about it, or because it's just sort of a subject one doesn't
raise? I think it's not something they don't talk about. Executions aren't something that they pretend do not exist. They talk about them. They talk about executions. They talk about capital punishment. But I don't think they are non-emotional discussions of it. They have feelings which about it from their own point of view, from the possibility that they will be executed, which make it very difficult to look at it objectively. And conversations tend not to get very deep about the subject.
The average person who is in death row, I take it, is not somebody about whose about whom the question seriously arises, did he do it? There are rather other questions. Was he fairly tried? Was there provocation? Was there self-defense?
Yeah, for most of the people that have been on death rows during the period I was there, it was a question of degree. It was a question of whether this fellow did it or his partner did it, who shot the gun, or whether it was actually a robbery being planned at the time of the killing, which made it a felony murder. There are very few people I've ever seen, one or two people in Death House who very strongly argued that they did not do it. But the rest of them, they felt that they got that it was an unfair conviction, or that the sentence, they shouldn't have gotten the death sentence, they should have gotten life sentence. I can only think just right now offhand of two people who, from the time they came in till the time one of them went to the chair and the other one left with a new trial, they over and over and over and over said they weren't guilty.
And one of those went to the chair?
One of them, yeah. Uh-huh. 1963.
And this would be two out of how many?
I don't know, 30 or 40 men were in and out during the time I was there. Perhaps more.
Does the two include yourself, or does that make it three?
No, I don't include myself in those two, no. There are men who say they didn't do it, but I don't know whether they really mean that seriously or not. They don't make a point of arguing over and over, I'm innocent, I shouldn't be in here. They say, sometimes, there's a lot of kidding around going on in Death House. A great deal of joking, kidding back and forth. And it's easier to do that. It's easier to tell jokes than to be serious sometimes. And sometimes it's difficult to tell when a man is being serious or not. And whether when he says, I didn't do it, you know, I wasn't there or something, whether he really means it or not.
How is it possible to converse with these other inhabitants of the death house, since my understanding was that at least for the first 10 years or so, there was no community intercourse at all, no
well,
exercise.
We were always in ourselves. For the first 9.5 years, I was in my cell 24 hours a day, except for 15 minutes on Friday morning when I went out to take a shower. The rest of the time I was in the cell. If you needed to see the doctor, he came down, examined you in your cell. If you needed a tooth pulled, the dentist would come down and they'd bring you outside your cell, just outside of it, and they'd put a wooden chair there, and you'd sit in a wooden chair, and he'd pull your tooth right there and push you back in the cell. And the conversation was shouted back and forth, back and forth. We never saw each other except walking back and forth to the shower on Friday, or else men would get a mirror and hold it out and look around the corner into the next man's cell, and they could see each other back and forth that way. But then, since after 10 years, we moved to a new death house. They don't call it a death house anymore. They call it Three Wing now. And after a period of time, they begin allowing outside recreation, and Men get out for a shower every day now. And they get to see each other, going back and forth for visits and things. In the old place, the old death house, they had the visits right in the cell. People would come down and see you right in your cell. They wouldn't be allowed in your cell, they'd be outside. But in the new place now, they have the same visiting facilities as the general population. There's a great deal of contact between men and the death house. The solitary confinement doesn't really exist anymore.
What would have probably happened if, let us say, by the late 50s, 2 or 3 years after your conviction, you simply despaired of attracting the attention of a federal court? Would you have been executed?
Certainly. Any time I gave up, I would have been executed.
Well, didn't you have a court-appointed lawyer whose job it was not to
despair? Yes, well, I had a lawyer who departed rather abruptly after I had lost an appeal to the Federal District Court in New Jersey. And I asked one of the guards one night, how do you get a federal lawyer? And he said, you don't. And I said, why not? And he said, well, they just don't do it. So I wrote a letter to the Federal Court of Appeals in Philadelphia. And I said, I want to appeal. How about giving me a lawyer? And 2 days later, they gave me a lawyer. And I think I was about as surprised as anyone was, and they gave me Steve Lichtenstein. He has been with me now for 9 years. For a while paid by the court, and for a while by myself, and for a while unpaid. But he's been with me all this time. And had I not done that, it would have been a choice of writing the petition myself, writing the appeal myself, which I wasn't capable of doing, or being executed.
Did you subsequently acquire the skill to do it? I remember one judge there said that you
had professional skill. Yeah, there was a period of time. There was a period of time when I was without a lawyer, and it was either learn law or be executed. I had no choice, and I got as many law books as I could, and I sat down, I began reading them, and I began looking at some of the old petitions lawyers had filed for me in the past, and I figured out what the forms were and what the procedures were, and I became a lawyer, and I began representing myself, and I lost everything, but I stayed alive until 1965, and with your help, I got a lawyer. And since then, we've been winning until now it's over. But quite a few men do work on their own. Every man in the place, every man in the death house works on his own case. Whether he has a lawyer or not, he's always writing to his lawyer, always making suggestions, always telling his lawyer about things he has read, other legal briefs or in the newspapers, and they're always trying to help the lawyer. But only one or two have had to represent themselves.
When does your probation terminate?
1976.
What can't you do between now and 1976?
Pardon?
What can't you do between now, other than the obvious things?
Oh, I don't know yet. I have to telephone the probation officer Thursday morning, and we'll talk that over. The only thing I know is that I can travel. But what the conditions he will impose upon me, I'm not really sure what they all will be. I don't think the conditions will be very difficult. I'll probably have to report once a week or once every 2 weeks at the beginning. And that will...
What formal difficulties lie in your way in of a professional nature? Is there anything that disqualifies you to do anything?
Well, I couldn't be a lawyer or a police officer. Or certainly couldn't be a judge. I really haven't even thought about that right now. Present time, I'm trying to believe the fact that I'm not still in the death house. Yeah, very difficult.
You told me once you might like to be a private pilot. Is that
That was a long time ago. That was a long time ago. I would have liked to have been a lawyer at one time. Yeah. I don't think there's much chance of that now. The legal work interests me, and I would like to write about the law. I'd like to write about prisons, prison reform. I would like to write about criminal cases. It's something I know. It's something I know how to do. It's something I have experience with. I have some idea of how the people involved think and feel, having gone through it myself. And I think I'd like to write that type of thing. I'd like to cover the Angela Davis file if I could. I think that would be very interesting.
Is that something you can approach with an open mind?
I think I shouldn't comment on that here. depends on which side of the mind you mean is open.
Well, certainly not both.
No.
The journalism that you intend to do during the next period will include the completion of a book on
what? Yes, the first thing I have to do is complete the final story of this case. Brief Against Death covered my case from the time I was arrested until 1968. And I am just completing a book now which will take the case from 1968 through today. And thereafter, I hope I never have to write about myself again.
And do you understand that this is a book that you can publish before the end of the probationary period? Or would it have to wait until after that?
I expect it will be published quite soon.
But does that
mean... I don't
think
there'll be any problem with it.
Does that mean that you have to accept any inhibitions?
No.
Does that mean that you can say things in that book that you can't say here?
I think I can say anything I want in the book. I don't expect any problem with the probation people concerning my writing at all. I don't think they'll give me any problems with that.
They don't have the right to repeal the First Amendment?
Not that I've noticed. They may try, but I don't know if they will.
Do you feel any sense of bitterness towards the judge who sentenced you or the prosecutors who arranged the deal?
No. I think we all, all of us, the judge, the prosecutors, the attorney general, my lawyers and myself, we all did what we felt had to be done.
Yeah. Thank you very much, Mr. Smith.
You're welcome.
Printed copy of this program, send 25 cents to Firing Line, Post Office Box 5966, Columbia, South Carolina, 29205. That address again, Firing Line, Post Office Box 5966, Columbia, South Carolina, 29205. This program was made possible by a grant from the Corporation for Public Broadcasting.